हॅलो, गुड मॉर्निंग. आय एम मिस्टर व्ही डी साठे, असिस्टंट प्रोफेसर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ मेकॅनिकल इंजिनिअरिंग, वालचंद इन्स्टिट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नॉलॉजी. नॉट टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी द फर्स्ट युनिट ऑफ अवर ट्रान्झियंट सिस्टीम. अँड इन दॅट ट्रान्झियंट सिस्टीम, ॲज युजल, वी आर गोइंग टू सी दॅट वॉट विल यू विल बी एबल टू डू आफ्टर फिनिशिंग दिस सेशन. That is called as learning outcome. So learning outcome for today's session is that we will be able to discuss the necessary condition for stability. Now the important thing is, say before we start actual discussion, why it is important to study the necessary condition, then we'll see in the part 2 sufficient condition, then we see for other complications and say mathematical procedures for how to find out whether the system is stable, unstable or say marginally stable. Okay, now the simple question is, what is the meaning of transient system? Transient system is a system in which whenever we give input, the output changes for a short duration of time, and that is called as a transient behavior. And that behavior we are going to analyze. Now for our analysis, what we are going to study is whenever we have been given a characteristic equation of a system, that is a closed loop control system, how to decide whether the system is stable or not. If it is stable, whether it is permanently, that is asymptotically stable or not, or if it is unstable, what are the reasons for its instability, and if it is marginally stable, how we can identify from the particular, say, equation, whether it is under these three categories. Now, my first question to you is, you already know, you have studied the block diagram, and you know that we can have canonical form, that is known as a block diagram in which we have got one input, then this is the summing point, then we have forward gain, that is G, then this is the output, which is taken takeoff point, and there is a feedback which is say H, and I have here the negative feedback. So this is my summing point, this is the input signal, this is negative, and this is the diagram. Okay, now we do our analysis assuming that it is a negative feedback. Now sometimes question may ask, sir, why there is what if there is a positive feedback, what to do? See, we are doing our calculations with negative feedback. And if there is a positive feedback, you have a choice. What you can do? You can just say make this plus, you can make this plus and have a negative sign in the feedback loop. So with a small change in our gain function, by changing its sign from, suppose it is a plus 5, then you can make it minus 5, and minus 5 added, it is equivalent to negative addition. So we have no problem whether we take our system as positive feedback or negative feedback. So we will do our analysis assuming that there is a negative feedback. Now we know from our block diagram algebra that the closed loop transfer function for this has got, say, GH upon GH. Okay, so we have got a numerator here and denominator is 1 plus GH if it is a negative feedback. I'm not talking about numerator, because in the numerator we don't have to worry, because even if numerator is zero, zero is not a mathematical problem. But when zero comes in the denominator, it creates a singularity. Singularity means a problem is there. For singularity is we cannot define the function there. Function is not continuous at that particular point. And if it is continuous within the proximity, we have to go for a very fine calculus for that particular thing. Okay, now the next thing is, for this 1 plus GH, what will happen? This will be a polynomial in S. This will be a polynomial in S. So there is some polynomial. There is some polynomial in S. Now what is the degree of polynomial? That degree of polynomial may be, it may be linear, it may be quadratic, third order, fourth order, nth order polynomial I can have. Now today we are restricting ourselves to the equation which is our, say, characteristic equation, which we are getting in the form of a quadratic. Suppose it is a s square plus b s plus c. Now this is a quadratic equation. Now the main thing about our tangent system stability is, whenever I draw a diagram or a graphical representation, on this axis I have real number, on this axis I have got omega, that is say negative number, that is a imaginary number. So any point lying on this axis, this particular plane, is on the left of S plane. So this side is known as left of S plane, because we are working in S plane now, and this is the right of S plane. So this is the right side. Now see, there is a slight difference in our regular coordinate system and the system of coordinate system that we use for our, say, tangent system analysis, which again we use for our root locus analysis also. Now you can see here, the particular, say, equation has got roots. Now for a quadratic, you know, what is the possibility for roots? All two roots may be real, all two roots may be imaginary, two roots may be irrational numbers, and out of these two real roots, both may be same, and out of these two real roots, they may be positive or they may be negative, or one is positive and one is negative. So as far as our stability is concerned, we are interested only in the left half of S plane. So this is a stable region. So always remember, this is my stable region. So I want my equation, that is the characteristic equation, which I have obtained for a closed loop transfer function, and its denominator equated to zero, I will get some polynomial in S. Now the question is, how to identify whether my system is going to be stable or not? So first thing is, first criteria is, it all the roots must lie on the left side. So all roots must be present in this region. Okay. Now, in this region means there are two possibilities. Either my root may be somewhere here on this axis, that is a real axis, which is a negative x-axis, or my root may be here. See what, how I am drawing the particular, say, roots. When I say the roots are here on the left half of S plane, when I show one root here, second root here, one root here, second root here, means whatever the roots I get, they are symmetrically placed about the real axis, because the complex roots I am getting in this plane, as long as I am on this line, it is real. But when I shift either above or below, I will get a complex number. Complex number has a form, that is the simple form that you know, which you have already studied in your previous classes, which is a plus ib. A plus ib is my complex number. So when b is 0, it is a real number. When a is greater than 0, it is to the right side. If a is less than 0, it is to the left side of 0. Is that not? And if a is 0 and b is 0, it is the origin. So now, when my root is lying on this axis, it is going to be on the negative real axis. And if the root lies on the complex plane, if it is a quadratic, both the roots must be complex conjugates, because that is the necessary condition. That is the first part. But the stability criteria requires certain things which are mathematical in nature. It says that whatever the polynomial you have, it must be complete polynomial. Now, what is the meaning of complete polynomial? Suppose I write a polynomial 3x cube plus 2x square plus 3 is equal to 0. If I write this polynomial, the problem is with this is that the x cube term is present, x square term is present, but term in x is absent. So when the term in x is absent, that system can never be a stable system. Means first condition, necessary condition, is that equation must be a complete polynomial. And because it is complete polynomial, that is a square plus bs plus c, or I will take another example, it is s square plus 5s, say plus 6 is equal to 0. Now if I see this polynomial, and if I ask you factor this, so you'll factor this as s plus 3 and s plus 2 is equal to 0. So what are the values? S is equal to minus 2 and s is equal to minus 3. So it will be minus 2 here and minus 3 here. So essential condition is that all the coterms must be present. It must be a complete polynomial. That is the first condition. Second important condition is that the coefficients of all the terms, that is s square s and constant, or s cube s square s and constant, must have same sign. Must have same sign. Same sign means it can be plus, 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 or it can be minus, minus, minus. Because if it is minus, 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 it makes no difference. I can get still by multiplying minus 1 the same answer. But on the contrary, suppose it is s square minus 5s plus 6 is equal to 0. Now my roots are s minus 2 into s minus 3 is equal to 0, and s is equal to 2 and s is equal to 3. So what is happening now? I will get two roots here. So the stability condition says that your roots must be on the left half of the s-plane. It should not be on the right half of the s-plane. That is the necessary condition. That is the first part. And if my polynomial is only up to, say, quadratic, linear and quadratic, this condition is also the sufficient condition. Means if my particular function is like this, I will say that without any problem, as it is quadratic, as it is a complete quadratic, and as the coefficients of all the terms have same sign, not necessarily positive, it is same sign, then the system is going to be stable because all the roots will lie on the left half of S plane. So this is our first introduction about the transient system, in which we find out whether the system is stable or not. If it is a quadratic, we have studied that for quadratic equation to be stable, necessary and sufficient condition is the same. That is, it must satisfy, there must be complete polynomial, no term is missing, and the coefficients of all the terms are having same sign. So I think with this particular, you have got the idea about the particular thing, and you can now, if you want to refer, you can refer Automatic Control Engineering by Raven, by Bakshi, and by Barpette. So thank you for your patience listening. Now in the second module, we will see the further extension of this topic. Thank you.